stretched out on a tree and took the nails from me. He's living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. And buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he
morning. A little bit of a rush this morning. Apologies for being a little bit of late for those who are watching online. You're very welcome to Sunday morning service in, where am I? High Street. Oh dear, it's been one of those, it's been one of those mornings. Anyway, a couple of things just to just to remind you of. It's amazing how we're getting so close to Christmas, isn't it? And when you came in this morning, you got one of these, I think, on the way in. And this is what we gave out to staff members at Follow the Star this week. And we thought it would be good to order some of these for ourselves. If you look at the on the back, those of you who have a smartphone, there's a little QR code down at the bottom that you can use your smartphone to get into to download an app that gives you all kinds of readings for Advent and over the Christmas period. So those of you that don't have a smartphone, you used to have a bookmark, okay? But there's some really good thoughts, and it's all about preparing ourselves for for Christmas and the reason why we celebrate. So please do take those away. To say too that our youth service is next Sunday on a Christmas theme, and that's going to be in the morning service on the 11th, and then the following Sunday, which is the 18th, the last Sunday before Christmas, in the circumstances this year, we'll be holding our carol service in the morning. Here in the hall at 11 o'clock, and there'll be other announcements that are in the announcement sheet there that give details of those and other things as well. So, I want to begin then with the lighting of the Advent candles. So again, if you would join with me in the words that are in the red, and I'll do the words that are in the blue here. For many of us, the call to head home is one of joy and hope, and of hope. We can't wait to reconnect with family, with history and tradition, with a wonderful time of freedom and loving support. We can't wait to go home together. There are those who fear going home. However, there are times when going home brings back memories that are not so good, not so healing. We are reminded of when we didn't fit in, when we didn't measure up, when we weren't loved like we need to be loved. Home can be a difficult place for some. The prophet Malachi tells us that even when we are in the hottest of fires, there is a presence who can make us better, who can refine and purify. John the Baptist tells us that the road home is always under construction, mountains leveled and valleys filled in, to make smooth the path that leads us to our true destination, where we can live in peace and unity with all. We light these candles, the candle of hope and the candle of peace, as a sign of our assurance that though the road is hard, we believe it is worth the journey. It is time to go home. And I hand over to Ruth and the team for our opening praise.
Good morning. Let's all stand together. Let's just pray. Father, just thank you that we can be here together in your presence. Lord, we just love you so much, and we just thank you that at this Advent time, when we think of you coming to this earth, Lord, I pray that you will open our eyes and our ears and our hearts to more of your love, to see you as you are, Lord, and to really worship you. Father, we just pray your blessing on us this morning, in Jesus' name.
Joy to the world.
Let's continue in an attitude of prayer. Let us pray. Lord, as we've just offered to you our worship, it is an expression of our rejoicing in this season of good news and of goodwill. The time of the year when we celebrate once more the birth of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who came as the Prince of Peace, the Lord of Lords, the Word who was made flesh. And we praise you this day for the assurance of his final triumph, that as you came, O God, through him, so you shall come again. For coming amongst us through Jesus, for the way in which he bore our flesh and our blood, for living our life and sharing our humanity, for entering our world, loving God, this morning we rejoice and we praise you. For suffering and dying amongst us, for your victory over death, your triumph over evil, and your promise that the kingdom will come. Loving God, we rejoice and we praise you. And so for the wonder of this season, for its message of love and forgiveness, for its promise of peace and justice, for the gift of life everlasting of which it speaks, loving God, we rejoice and we praise you. And so, loving God, we rejoice again in this season of good news and goodwill. And we look forward to that day when the Jesus of Bethlehem will be and declared the Lord of all, as you came through him, so you shall come again. For it is in Jesus' name that we praise you. And we share together the prayer that Jesus himself has taught us to pray, to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Well, we had a wonderful week last week with Follow the Star, which, as you know, was the first time that we were able to do this since 2019 as a result of the COVID pandemic. And it was just amazing once again to bring onto our premises over 200 children and staff from four schools over the week. And there was such a great bunch of volunteers. In fact, there was, I think, well over 30 people that were involved in some way, whether it was supplying shortbread or bringing scones to feed the actors in the midst of it all, and so on. That it was just a great combined effort from the congregation. I know Morva would love to say thank you to all of the volunteers that worked away in the background and turned up each day and made Follow the Star one of the highlights of the year. You forget just how much we missed it until we started doing it again. And our prayer has been that as the kids go home and even the staff go home, but particularly the kids go home and share the excitement that was so obvious when they came and talk at home about what they saw, what they learned, what they were able to take home and so on. We just pray God will sow seeds through all of that. And it helps our church to connect with the community too in which we're placed. Now, you will know that, and we've done this before, is that it's time now for the presentation of the Follow the Star Oscars that are known as the the Santas. And so, all ready to go? So this is the presentation for, I'm not sure if he's out this morning or not, but for his main role as the grumpy innkeeper, and for his role for one day only as his ugliness, King Herod, as he called himself, was Morris Laverty. I don't think Morris is here today. Is he? So you take one of those. Would anybody like to come up and get a... And to get an Oscar, to bring an Oscar back to your grandpa? Emily, go and take that. Okay? That's for your grandpa, okay? Not for you. Yeah. For her role as the substitute innkeeper and as the younger Mary, Hazel Farmer. Hazel. And best newcomer in her role as the innkeeper's wife was Heather Hayburn. For their roles as the slightly older Mary to the very young Joseph, Dawn Hamilton and Ruth Best. And then for his role as a shepherd with his singing sheep, that was Victor McMullen. Victor! Where is he? And for her role as a shepherd charged to try and keep Victor the shepherd on message was Alison Agnew. And then for her role as a shepherd who always made sure that the shepherd's supper was ready, and that's Grace Hamilton. And for their role over the week as the wise men who loved to just to follow the star was John Trimble and James Farmer. So James, I know you're here today. And Anne, there you are. Anne, if you would take that back to your beloved John and say thank you to John and to James. For his role as the evil, I have a cunning plan, Herod, Mark Hand. And Andrew, who did the innkeeper as well, not just the Andrew that's sitting down there, but the other Andrew that works for BNL, he will get his Santa in due course because he helped with being the innkeeper in 1 week. But of course, there wouldn't be Follow the Star right from the very start if it wasn't really for two people. First of all, Wendy Watts, who was the voice and has been the voice of the angel for the last, since this started, and for once again coordinating the craft activities and all the behind the scenes stuff. So Wendy, I've got a little gift for you here. Is there names? What's it? On the tag, there's no tag. There's a tag. The star, sorry. Yes, Wendy. With grateful thanks once again for all of you being here. And of course, the one and only Morva Calvert, who... You see,
without more of a Follow the Star would not happen. When I remember when I went to your door and said, what about Follow the Star? And there was all kind of, well, what would it do and so on. But I think once we took that plunge, it has really been really worth it. And we've been blessed by it. And we're blessed to have more of her and all that she does for Follow the Star and so much else in the life of the church too. Yes, and for God as well. And all being well, and God's planning, and to God be the glory, we will be have the health and strength to, you know, to do this again next year. So finally, before the kids go out, any birthdays in the past week? Are any birthdays this week? No? Okay. Oh, who is it? Josh. You're a big fella now. There you are. What would you like? There we are. Okay. Okay, so we're going to sing happy birthday to Josh, okay?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Josh.
Josh.
Happy birthday to you.
So let us pray. Lord, we just thank you for Follow the Star and for the fun that we had and the hard work that it was putting it all together. And to you we give the glory. And we just thank you for our young people, Lord, and we just pray God's peace and presence and blessing as they go out now to kids' church, to Bible class, and to the creche, Lord. We just lift them before you and pray that they will enjoy their activity this morning and learn more what it means to know and to love Jesus. And we pray in his name. Amen. Well, guys.
Sun above. Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before you, opening to the sun.
So for a reading from God's Word this morning, I ask you to turn to the second letter of Peter, near towards the end of the Scripture, the New Testament, 2 Peter chapter 3, and we're going to read from verse 1. And so let us hear the Word of God. Dear friends, this is now my second letter to you, and I've written both of them as reminders to stimulate you to wholesome thinking. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by our Lord and Savior through your apostles. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, "Where is this coming he promised?" Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and the destruction of the ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar, The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. Ending at verse 13, and we thank God that his word still speaks to us today. So let us move into our prayers for others, and at the end of each petition, when I say, Lord, in your mercy, our response is, hear our prayers. Let us pray. And so in the power of the Holy Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to God our Father, who hears our prayers and answers them according to his good and perfect will. Almighty God, in our journey through Advent, we think of the part John the Baptist played to announce the coming of Jesus. Lord, give us the courage to be faithful like John in his proclamation of the Messiah, and to be able to bear fruits that are worthy of repentance until all your promises are fulfilled. Lord, help us to look forward in hope to the second coming of our Savior. May we live as Jesus taught. May we be ready to welcome him when he comes again. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. You who are our faithful God, we want to pray for Christians throughout the world and for your blessing on all services and events that will be held across the world during this Advent and Christmas season. We particularly pray for those people who will only go to church at this special time of the year. And we ask, Lord, on their behalf that they may feel, through their coming to these events, that they may feel something more of the sense of your love for them. And may they, Lord, commit their lives to you as a result. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. You who are our Creator God, we continue to pray for parts, for people in parts of the world where life is precarious, whether that be through disasters, through poverty, through disease, through droughts, through flooding, or wars. We pray that the time may be hastened when there is peace on earth and goodwill between all people. And we lift before you and pray for our precious world, and bring before you all the discussions that happened at the recent climate change conference in Egypt. May the decisions that have been made there help us all to be good stewards, so that we can pass on our world in better order to the generations that are yet to come. We pray for people in our own country who are struggling due to the increases in the cost of living and the energy prices. Lord, please show us how we can help people in need in our local community during this festive period. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Father God, as we approach Christmas, we confess that we often fail to hear you, that we can be so busy at times that we hardly give a thought to what our lives and the season of Advent are all about. So easily our spirits can grow tired, and even you, Father God, can sometimes seem far away. So we ask, Lord, you would help us to listen, to hear your voice today, and to be with us by your Spirit, to be with us as we go out to purchase every gift that we buy, thinking of the people that we're giving them to when we wrap those gifts, and be with those who will receive and open those gifts on Christmas Day. praying God's blessing upon them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Loving God, we thank you for the gift of life and pray for those whose lives are troubled by illness, grief, poverty, or great injustice. We pray that in the darkness of their suffering and pain, that your Advent light would shine to bring them the assurance and the hope of the coming of your Son, Jesus. And in a moment of silence, let us remember those known personally to us who need your help today, Lord. Father God, we ask you to draw close to all of those that are in our heart and mind at this moment, so that they may be aware of your presence. And we ask you to provide your peace and your comfort for them at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Loving God, we pray for those who have died recently, or for those who at this time of the year is an anniversary of a loved one's passing. Lord, be near to all who mourn and comfort them with the knowledge that in the coming of your Son, Jesus, the gates of heaven have been opened wide for all who will accept him as their Lord and Savior. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And so, merciful God, who sent John the Baptist to proclaim the good news, help us when we go from this church this morning to be true heralds of the coming of Christ and to proclaim the gospel through all that we do and say. Merciful God, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now Ruth will lead us in another praise.
Let's stand together as we sing, There Is a Hope.
Of glory.
Please be seated.
Advent is waiting time, and it's a time where we prepare ourselves for the great celebration of Christmas, celebrating the first coming of Jesus into our world as the baby in the manger, the story, of course, that lies at the very heart of Follow the Star this past week. But the Bible also talks about another promise of what is going to happen in the future. The time when the risen and ascended and living Lord Jesus will return again to the world to usher in the fullness of God's kingdom here on earth. Indeed, Luke records at the very beginning of the book of Acts that when Jesus was taken up to heaven, that two angels appeared and said to the disciples who were gazing up into the sky and said this, "Men of Galilee, why are you standing there looking up into the sky? For this same Jesus who has been taken into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Indeed, earlier in the same chapter, Luke tells us that no one but God knows the day when Jesus will return. Although many people have attempted down through the years to put all kinds of theories and dates into people's mind through the many books that have been written about the second coming of Jesus. When in the end, the thing is this, that if we believe what the Bible says, only God the Father knows when this will happen. I wonder, is this something that you've ever given much thought to? Advent, yes, is the time of the year when, in addition to focusing on the first coming of Jesus as the baby in the manger at Bethlehem, there's also a need to focus on what is still to come. It's what the Bible calls the second coming of Jesus. It's also interesting to note that many of the first generation Christians lived with a high, eager expectation that Jesus would return in their lifetime. And then what you begin to see is that after time passes, some of those early Christians slowly but surely begin to lose hope. They so wanted Jesus to return to put an end to all the brokenness and lack of peace that they were seeing in their world at that time. And so we can see the kind of situation then that Peter was addressing in this second letter, where he writes these words in verses 3 and 4. Above all, he said, you must understand that in the last days before Jesus comes, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. And they will say, well, where is this coming that he promised? Making the point that ever since our ancestors died, everything just seems to go on as it has since the beginning of creation. And in reading those words, I couldn't help thinking, but all these years later, that there's still plenty of scoffing that goes on in our generation, going on in our increasingly secular world that we live in, where Christians are increasingly being ignored, being laughed out, seen to be out of date. The name of Jesus is no longer treated with any reverence. It's reduced to a mere swear word. And the thought of Jesus coming back again is too ridiculous to give any credence to it. Maybe you might be thinking, much the same. We know about the fact that the Bible says Jesus comes, but will come again. But we're thinking, well, it's been over 2,000 years since those words were written. And we're still waiting. Christians are still waiting for the return of Jesus. But let me tell you, this is not how God thinks. Because the Bible tells us in Psalm 90 and verse 4 that in God's eyes, 1,000 years in your sight, in God's sight, are simply like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. And what that says to me is that our human understanding of time and how time passes is so limited to our own understanding and experience. But God's ways are not our ways. God's thinking is not our thinking. And so 1,000 years of our time scale in God's eyes is just like, passes just like a day.
A day does for us.
So Peter's response to the question of whether the Lord Jesus would return in their lifetime was to say to them, to remind them that the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise. As we as human beings sometimes understand slowness. Instead, it says that God is patient. That God is patient. God is not slow in keeping his promises. What he says will happen. But as God is patient with us in working all of this out, we also need to be patient. Because as I've said, God's timings are not our timings. His thinking is not our thinking. His ways are not our ways. I think the older that I get, the more I've become slower hurt in life, not just physically. But when even it comes to consuming food at Christmas time. When I was young, I was always the first to finish my Christmas dinner after having always the biggest plate of food. I was often told around the dinner table, "Harold, why do you eat so fast?" And my usual reply was to simply say, "Well, I was hungry." Those of you who have raised teenagers will know all about that. But as you get older, not only can you not take the same amount of food, but you do try to eat slower, maybe to appreciate more of the food that we're consuming. And so if God in his nature is a patient God, does this not challenge somehow the very hurried nature, the lack of patience that we show in the midst of our ever-increasingly busier lives, that we seem to live at a greater pace than ever before? We're living in an age where people demand instant replies to emails, tweets, Instagrams. Why is it that we always seem to look for the fastest checkout queue at the supermarket in order to get home quicker? Or why do we suffer a lack of patience when your computer seems to take an age to download something? Or even how your children dawdle over putting on their clothes or their shoes when you're trying to get them out for school? How patient are any of us when we're stuck behind a tractor or a slow lorry? I know I am. Why are we always rushing from one thing to another? The only thing I can say is, this is for the men. Do we not show much patience waiting for our wives to get ready for going out? Come on, men. They're all looking at their wives. I think, look, we need to learn better how we slow down and how we can receive the gift of having a godly patience in the midst of our hectic everyday lives. And Peter in this letter is saying to us that when it comes to waiting for the return of Jesus, not only are we called to be patient in the knowledge that God is going to keep his promise in his time, but that there is a reason why God is even still holding back on Jesus' return. And we see this in verse 9, where Peter is saying, God is patient with you. And the reason, he says, because God does not want anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Again, it's a picture that when it comes to eternal things, God is always so patient with us. And God's heart is that he does not want anyone to perish. And what that really means is that he doesn't want people to die without God in their lives. And that God's heart, if only we could see it, has a longing and a yearning that everyone would come to repentance, would come to see their need for God in their life, to seek the forgiveness of God for them, for their sins, for the mistakes that we have made in our journey through life, that we would come to that point where we would ask Jesus into our lives to be our Savior and our Lord. And so Peter was wanting to put over that point really strongly to the people he was writing to, because Jesus knew that when, that Peter knew that when Jesus returns again to earth, that he will be coming to pronounce a judgment over the earth. And but the Bible also clearly teaches that because of the death and the resurrection of Jesus, that when you commit your life to live wholeheartedly as a follower of Jesus, that we have nothing to fear from this coming judgment. But in saying that, entering the fullness of God's kingdom does require us to believe in him, to come before God in that spirit of repentance that says, Lord, I need you. And so this is why God is patiently holding back the return of Christ, so that everyone on this earth would have the chance to respond to his greatest gift of forgiveness and restoration through what Jesus has done for us on the cross, what we are remembering at the climax of our service today as we celebrate communion together. I think I'm way ahead here. God's judgment is described by Peter in verse 10. Where he says, the day of the Lord, in other words, when the time when Jesus comes, he will come like a thief. This thief tends to sneak in, sneak out without people seeing him or her. But Jesus will come like that, like a thief, suddenly. The heavens, it says, will disappear with a roar, the elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. It's a verse that is sometimes often misunderstood, because this is not saying that God is going to destroy the earth that he has made. It doesn't say that, and that when we talk about Christian hope, that what we mean is going to heaven as a place you go to be with Jesus after you die. What he's trying to say here is that heaven and the Christian hope that we've just been singing about in that last song is actually not the final destination for the Christian. And we see that first traced way back in the book of Isaiah, where God says through Isaiah, there's a time coming when, see, I will create a new heaven and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered, nor will they come to mind. And so Peter is trying to encourage his readers by taking up this theme and saying that in keeping with his promise, we too need to look forward to this time when a new heaven and a new earth will happen after that time of judgment. This is the same new heaven and new earth which John also sees as recorded in the book of Revelation, in Revelation 21, verses 1 and 2. But the question is, what does this new heaven and new earth mean? What kind of new are these writers trying to describe or put into words? Well, the Greek word neo used here is in the sense of something of new, as something that does not, that did not exist before. But there's also another Greek word that's used in these passages, which is the word kainos, which is about something being renewed or remade. And kainos is the same word used to describe the inner transformation that happens when you become a Christian. That time when you find Christ and you invite Christ into your life, that in Christ you become a new creation. You become literally a new person on the inside. The hold that sin has had over your life is broken and it's gone and is to be replaced by a renewed, a holy and restored life within. God is not going to put the heavens and the earth that he created literally into the bin and to start again. But God's great restoration plan is that he's going to take this world that we currently live in, he's going to refine it, he's going to remake it, and he will renew it. And judgment becomes before that renewing, remaking of the new heaven and the new earth, where everything is going to be renewed. That is the time when we will be given our, for those who are Christians, we'll be given our new bodies. Knowing that when Jesus rose from the dead, Jesus looked the same, he sounded the same, but yet his body was different. It was a resurrected body. And it's at that time, in that process of renewal and so on, that we will be given our new resurrected bodies. And so God's judgment that precedes this acts as, and again it's hard to get the to try and understand with our limited mind, but it's described here, it acts like a cleansing fire which seeks to burn away all impurities. Malachi writes about this judgment right at the end of the Old Testament when he said, but who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears, when Jesus comes back again? But he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap that, and he will sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver. So what that picture is about is that God's judgment is going to be like this fire that will refine the earth until pure gold is left. In other words, everything that is bad in this world will go, and the only thing that will be left is everything that is good. God's final judgment is going to burn away all that is unjust in our world, all that is impure in our world, all that is ungodly in our world. That's what it means when he talks about laying bare the earth until the old order of things that we're living through at the moment in this world, that they have been destroyed and have gone forever. Indeed, if you read the book of Revelation towards the end, when John had that incredible revelation, seeing right into heaven and Jesus, you know, spoke to him. John wrote and he talked about this, the city of God, the new Jerusalem, which is literally, you know, literally heaven coming down to earth. The old order of things will have passed away. And God promises heaven on earth, a restored planet forever. In other words, Eden is restored. Eden that we see at the beginning of the book of Genesis, where God created a perfect world and that man had a perfect relationship with God. And then as we know in Genesis 3, because of man's disobedience to God and decided to go his own way, that all that we call sin and all the fruits of sin started to come into our world, like pain and sickness and health issues and death and horrible things like that, injustice, impurity. Eden will be restored again. This new heaven and new earth will be a place where there will be no more sin. There will be no more fear. There will be no more tears. There will be no more viruses. There will be no more cancer. And there will be no more death. It's an incredible picture, isn't it? And I've only very, very briefly touched on it this morning of what the future, you know, holds for all of us who in this life believe in our Lord Jesus Christ and are saved. And so in this Advent season, there is a call, because of what we have been talking about this morning, there's a call for us to live with an active expectation, knowing that when we are waiting for something,
knowing what you're waiting for actually changes how you wait. For example, a child waiting for a Christmas present has a very different attitude to a child waiting to go in to see the dentist. Or waiting for your wedding day is very different to waiting for your car to be MOT'd. The future, you see, that lies ahead for every Christian is beyond the human, what the human mind can fully take in or imagine. Eternity with Jesus is not sitting playing a harp on a fluffy cloud. Sorry, Victor. And yet it's amazing, you know, the pictures that people have of heaven and reducing it to that kind of image, when it is far more beautiful and wonderful than that. What we're waiting for is the renewal, the restoration of a new heaven and a new earth when all things will be made new. It'll be then that we will fully not only understand but experience what life in all its fullness that Jesus came to bring will actually be fulfilled for us. We still look through things very darkly at the mysteries that are ahead of us. And anything in a sense that we experience of God in this life will always simply be a foretaste to the incredible joy we'll feel and experience when we see Jesus face to face. I don't know about you, but when you start to contemplate these things, even if we were to catch a glimpse of this incredible, beautiful future that God has for all of us who believe, ought that not to change how we live today? Peter, the end of the passage that I read, says that since everything of the old order of things will be laid bare or destroyed in this way, what kind of people then ought we to be in this life? He talks about living a holy and a godly life as we are a people who look forward to the day of God and would speed its coming by the way that we live. Maybe we say, you know, we don't talk to our people about what is to happen in the future. Maybe we should. Maybe we should have a greater heart for people who don't know Jesus, of trying to contemplate what eternity would be like living eternity without God, without love in the world. It should make us more urgent in the conversations that we say, and it's not what we say, it's how we go about it. It's building the relationships, as we heard when we were doing the evangelism course. It's building up trust between people so that when you say something, they will actually have a greater chance of accepting what you're saying to them, or at least to talk it through. We don't want anybody to have a regret of witnessing, as I have witnessed many times through my ministry, of people dying without the Lord in their lives, and great regret from some of their Christian family members that they didn't have those conversations. I just rejoice, Roy, that you had that conversation with your dad. And what a difference that made to what was a hard day for you and for the family. But to know the hope of heaven, the hope of being part of that new creation, is what sees us through. We are to live wholeheartedly as followers of Jesus for the transformation of the world. It's before us every Sunday. We are to live this life that is pleasing to God, to become imitators of Jesus, someone who is prepared to stand up for truth, someone prepared to stand up for fairness and justice in our world. And yes, these are exciting and challenging times to share the good news of Jesus. with others.
And we need to look forward with an act of patience towards the second coming of Jesus. Maybe it will come in our lifetime.
And also to say that if you don't know Jesus as your Savior and Lord, you desperately need to get ready. You need not just to, I'm sure that it's not even a case of you've heard the call of Jesus upon your life. If you've been coming to this church over the years and so on, you know the gospel. You know it in your head and so on, but I urge you, you need to get ready if you've not made that decision to follow Jesus. Surrender your life into his hands. If you don't know what the forgiveness of sins is for you, if you don't know what it means to be at peace with God, maybe this morning after what you've heard that God is speaking to you again, if you want to say your yes to Jesus, maybe even for the first time, then as I've always said, coming forward to receive communion is a way of saying your yes to him. John Wesley used to talk about the communion table as being a converting table, a table of response. And he often would, in his preaching and so on, when he was celebrating communion and so on, he would have called those who don't know Jesus but were challenged by the message that was preached and so on, even if they had never come to communion before, to come to the Lord's table. Not John Wesley's table, not Harold Agnew's table, it's not the Methodist table, it's the Lord's table, where we remember all that he has done for us. And that's why I have been so encouraged over these last number of years to see increasing numbers of people in this congregation who never stayed for communion beginning to stay for communion. And I just rejoice that God has been speaking into people's lives. And it's between you and the Lord. It's between you and the Lord. And so what will be your response today as we come to his table? Amen. Ruth, I'm going to ask you to come as we move into the James, I would like you to help me with communion this morning. And we're going to sing a song that about the second coming and lift your worship to the Lord.
So let's stand together.
Nations are still
ask you to join in the responses that are in the black. God of all glory, you brought the universe into existence and raised up witnesses to your greatness and love. We praise you and adore you. Grant that by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we may worship and serve you and praise your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. So let us confess our sins to God, trusting in his mercy and forgiveness. Saying together, Holy and forgiving God, we have sinned against you and each other in thought and word and deed. We have turned from your life-giving word and ignored the message of those you sent. We are unprepared for the coming of your Son. I am making all things new, says the Lord. This is Christ's gracious word. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Thanks be to God. Lord our God, keep us, your servants, alert and watchful as we await the return of Christ, your Son, so that when he comes and knocks at the door, he may find us vigilant in prayer with songs of praise on our lips. And we ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The great prayer of thanksgiving. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. God of all glory and the light of our salvation, we offer you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. By your living word, you called all things into being, breathed into life the desire of your heart, and shaped us in your own likeness. Though we rejected your love, you did not give up on us or cease to fashion our salvation. You made a covenant to be our God. You spoke to us through the prophets and prepared the way for our redemption. We praise you that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, the Lord of eternity, announced by angels and born of Mary. He became incarnate, fulfilling the promise of your salvation. And so we offer our praise with all your people on earth and in heaven. With the full chorus of your creation, we proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We praise you, Lord God, King of the universe, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the night in which he betrayed, he took bread and he gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples saying, take this and eat it. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way then, after supper, Jesus took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come in glory. He is Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Recalling his death and resurrection, and in obedience to his command, we celebrate the offering of his eternal sacrifice until he comes again. Through him, our priest and king, accept us as a living sacrifice, a people of your praise. Generous and holy God, pour out your Spirit that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us symbols of the body and blood of Christ. Refashion us in your image, that we may be found ready at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours, O Lord, forever and ever. Amen. So the bread that we break is a sharing in the body of Christ, and the cup that we take is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Happy are those who share the banquet. And we say together the prayer of humble access. Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy even to gather up the crumbs onto your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us. Amen. The true bread of heaven gives life to the world. Come all who are hungry, come and eat. Come all who are thirsty, you come and you drink. James, if you could join me. Body of Christ that was given for us, preserve us unto everlasting life. We take and eat, knowing all that Christ has done for us. Blood of the Lord Jesus that was shed for you, James, preserving us unto everlasting life. Take and drink, remembering that Christ's blood was shed for you, and for that we are truly thankful. Amen. And we will take communion together in the way that we've been doing it recently, starting on this side and working from the back, and then when that side's finished, then the other side to come. James will be over here with the bread, and I will be here with the wine.
Oh, I can't be with you, 'cause I'm so far away. But I'm thinking of you. I hope that you can feel it, 'cause every single day I'm praying for you. And maybe you'll know that they're there as they cover you now while you walk through your day. And maybe they're always around, 'cause I'm not gonna stop, so I'm letting you know. Just ask for angels to walk around you, to let you know you're not alone when this whole world is feeling cold. I ask for angels to go and love you, to do the thing I just can't do, though I am so in love with you. And if you cry, don't cry. Those angels will hold you. And maybe you know that they're there when you're needing some hope at the end of a day. Just ask for angels to walk around you, to let you know you're not alone when this whole world is feeling cold. I ask for angels to go and love you, to do the thing I just can't do, though I am so in love with you. If you cry, don't cry. Those angels will hold you. I just ask for angels to fly above you, to lift your heart when you're alone and think you'll never make it home. I ask for angels to go and love you, to do the thing I just can't do, though I am so in love with you. I ask for angels to walk around you, to let you know you're not. Don't cry, those angels will hold you.
Before I pronounce the blessing, just to say that that we are in the early new year on the Wednesday, Thursday, Friday of the first week in January, holding the a prayer room up in the Wesley Trust, that we're encouraging people to drop in over that period of time. I think it's in the mentioned in the bulletin and will be mentioned over the next coming Sundays. If you can help in any way, if they're helping putting that prayer room together, if you could give your name to Alison as soon as possible so that we can get things prepared for something that's going to happen early in the new year. That would be great. Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you and prepare your heart and soul to meet him when he comes in glory. And may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be yours now and always. Amen. The day of the Lord is surely coming. Be faithful in worship, unwavering in hope, fervent in the work of God's kingdom, and all the more as you see this day drawing near. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Read that you are near to those whose hearts